Hi there, Doug Stuman with IT Creations with the Lenovo ThinkStation P3 Tower Gen 2. Again. But this time, we're looking at the CPU and GPU. In this case, the Intel Ultra Core 9 285 and the NVIDIA RTX 5000 Ada Generation GPU. I'm going to try and keep this short, so if you want to see more information, just remember you can pause the video. Let's get to it! We use Cinebench R23 and the 3D Mark application for the CPU and GPU respectively. If you're interested in seeing the full review of the Lenovo ThinkStation P3 Tower Gen 2 workstation, click that link right there. Here are the basics for our testing purposes. The system was outfitted with a single Intel Core Ultra 9 285 Series 2 CPU, NVIDIA RTX 5000 Ada generation, two 32GB memory modules for 64GB of DDR5 unbuffered memory, and a single M.2 NVMe Gen 5 1TB SSD in a PCIe 5.0x4 slot. On this platform, memory will top out at 5600 megatransfers because of platform limitations. But you could install unbuffered unclocked DIMMs capable of speeds up to 6400 megatransfers per second. But still, it would knock it down to 5600 megatransfers. This CPU was launched earlier this year in Q1 of 2025 and is roughly about $500 plus or minus. It has a TOPS score, or trillion operations per second, of 36, which is really not that high, but high enough for advanced on-device AI workloads and is a direct measure of the Neural Processing Unit, or NPU, which is part of the CPU architecture. You can run Copilot and a few light AI workloads. Total cores, 24, and that includes 8 performance cores and 16 efficiency cores, equating to 24 virtual threads as well. These Intel Core Ultra CPUs do not have hyperthreading technology like the previous generation Core I processors. Performance core frequencies of 2.5 GHz, P-Core Max Turbo frequency of 5.4 GHz, cache at 40 MB with a processor-based power rating of 65 watts, and a maximum turbo power rating of 182 watts. I left out the E-Core performance stats because these tests surely will be using the P-Cores. Are you interested in this little Lenovo ThinkStation P3 Tower Gen 2? Or maybe that Intel Core Ultra CPU, or even that NVIDIA RTX 5000 Ada generation GPU? If yes, then check out IT Creations. We have those systems, CPUs, GPUs, and more, a lot more. Click that link to visit IT Creations and let the window shopping begin. Admittedly, there were a few software problems with the initial launch of the Intel Core Ultra Series 2 processors. At this point, allegedly, those shortcomings have been addressed. That said, AMD is still knocking on Intel's door. Well, maybe kicking it in. That said, the CPU was quite fast, taking just 23 seconds to fill in that little breakfast nook. It clocked in at a score of 33,741 ROUSs. That'd be my made-up name for this random numerical score. Just to remind you, raster output under stress. I think what's missing from that image is a dog on the couch or maybe a rodent of unusual size. Now onto the 3D Mark for the GPU trials. Installed is the double-width NVIDIA RTX 5000 Ada generation. Surprisingly, this is the first time we've run this card through the paces. We will run a few modules, including TimeSpy Extreme, which simulates a 4K monitor, even though we are doing screen capture on a 4K monitor. Also, Port Royal, Speedway, and a test of DLSS4. All are measuring DirectX 12 performance, plus lighting effects, shadows, specular light, volumetric light reflections, and a few other things. But they are all mostly looking at the same characteristics of a preferred gaming experience. The DLSS, or Deep Learning Super Sampling, is somewhat the exception in that additional graphics frames are added to enhance playback with more frames per second. It can multiply frames by a factor of 5 using AI to generate most of those frames, all while also enhancing image quality. Basic stats for the RTX 5000 Ada include 32GB of GDDR6 memory, 12,800 shading units, 400 fourth generation tensor cores, and 100 third generation ray tracing cores. This card has a base clock of 1,155 MHz and a boost clock of 2,550 MHz. The memory bandwidth is listed at 576 GB per second with a 256-bit memory bus, all of which are just abstract numbers unless you have taken a deep dive into what it means. Nope, I won't be explaining all the minutia. Remember, keeping it short. Not surprised by the legendary performance of this card with a score of 12,813 ROUSs. The CPU clock frequency for the performance cores, measured by that purple line at the top, is maxing out at about 5200 MHz, with peaks at the stated 5400 MHz max turbo boost. That first part is just the demo, but you can see the other three vertical lines for graphic test 1, graphic test 2, and the CPU test at the end. Definitely some high frame rates for the estimated game performance. Here you can see all the system information. Then more granular details for the various performance measurements. The top graph represents frame rates at about 60 to 100 frames per second. Next, temperature for CPU in green and the GPU in blue. Then the percentage of load for the CPU in black and the GPU in red. Lastly, frequency in megahertz, which is the same graph we saw at the top of the page. So, enough said. And on that, we'll take a look at the next results for the next module, Speedway. Speedway is for testing sustained performance, reliability, and stability of your system. Playback looks great for Speedway, smooth. Looking at the stats again, legendary performance. No data available for estimated frame rates on other games. There's not a lot of action in the module, so performance is almost a straight line for CPU clock frequency in purple and GPU clock frequency in pink. The yellow line right below for GPU memory clock frequency is so close to the pink line, it almost looks orange, which would be the color for the frame rates, but that's not it. Here are the final stats and detailed monitoring with the same four charts we looked at for Speedway. The only slightly remarkable measure is for temperature, with that blue line for GPU, which is gradually increasing, and the bluish-green line for the CPU temperature, which was fairly consistent from start to finish. That said, this is a GPU test. Next, we have Port Royal, a benchmark for real-time ray tracing performance. Glass surfaces, shadows, volumetric lighting, those little dust motes floating in the air, and other stuff. Smooth playback and very nice global lighting. We'll just watch for a minute. Kind of a glimpse of the future where AI has taken over and humans are still looking for a nice lounge to relax and have a drink. Maybe take a few selfies with our food. Silly humans. And now it's like the Raid Roach Motel. Humans go in, but they don't come out. On to the stats. And just a reminder, if there is something you'd like to look at in more detail, pause the video. Once again, legendary performance with a score of 17,136 points. Clearly a great card for gaming and work too. We are looking at the same graphs as established with the TimeSpy module. In fact, all of these modules use the same graphs to measure performance. This is definitely one of the more interesting modules for light, shadow, global lighting, surfaces, and textures. Anyways, again, very consistent line for the CPU performance and GPU performance once the module gets up to speed, with GPU clock and GPU memory clock, pink and yellow respectively, running pretty much in tandem. Once we look at the more granular data at the end, you can see some temperature rise for the GPU, while the CPU seems to maintain a reasonably consistent temperature variation. And now on to the DLSS test, which is a variation on the Port Royal module. For the first part, it shows the rendering of the video with DLSS disabled to get a baseline of the card performance just for running the graphics. The next part actually renders at a lower resolution, and then DLSS reconstructs the output resolution. Apparently with DLSS 4, with multi-frame generation, like on this card, we get 3 extra frames per real frame, compared to only 1 additional frame if this card had just DLSS 3. There has been discussion on the various forums and whatnot that DLSS 4 is actually creating greater latency because the system has to use the space between the two images to recreate a few more and insert them as the game is running. I think there could be some validity to that, but I'm not sure we actually have the reflexes that it actually makes a difference. Maybe if we had cat reflexes, it would make a difference. I'm gonna stop talking now. This card is quite powerful because even without DLSS, we're running at mid-30s to lower 60s on frame rates without sacrificing image quality. And now part two with DLSS. With DLSS enabled, we're running at mid-130 frames to lower 170 frame count, and the image quality looks awesome. No stuttering, glitching, or anything of that nature. And now we can look at the stats again. From a statistical perspective, with DLSS off, we averaged around 38.74 frames per second on our 4K monitor. For the record, that output resolution is 3840 by 2160 pixels with the super resolution setting at performance. With deep learning super sampling enabled, we averaged 136.6 frames per second. Performance metrics for the frequency looks rock steady for the CPU and GPU clock and memory frequencies. This is where that top graph for frame rates gets interesting, because you can see the first part of the test with no DLSS and the second part with DLSS, separated by that vertical line. On the graph below for temperature, once again, GPU temperatures did start to increase, but it also flattened out shortly after the test started. The CPU, on the other hand, definitely rocked steady with some spikes, but very minimal temperature variation. Percentage graph will obviously favor the GPU, as this is a test of a function directly produced by the GPU, and you can see it working a little harder to generate frame rates between frames. I tried to keep it short, but here we are again. This is not just a good card, but a great card. But listed at between $3,800 and $5,000, I would expect that to be the case. In fact, I would demand it. I was actually quite impressed by the performance of the CPU as well. It too is quite fast and consistent. I didn't experience any of the problems that have plagued the Intel Core Ultra lineup and feel reasonably satisfied that those issues have been resolved. Allegedly. If you are interested in one of these CPUs, GPUs, or maybe even that Lenovo ThinkStation P3 Tower Gen 2, then do a little window shopping at IT Creations. You can use that link right there, or one of several links I placed below in the description. Until next time, dear viewers, I'm Doug Stuman with IT Creations. Thanks for watching.